How are you? This is a special episode to reach out to you to let you know that Reza and I are both okay, and we hope you are, and we hope that your families are too. Welcome to this coronavirus episode of
Aprender Inglés with Reza and Craig.
Hello, and if you're a new listener, you're very welcome. My name's Craig.
And my name is Reza.
And together with nearly 50 years of teaching English between us, Reza and I are going to help you improve your English and take it to the next level. This is a slightly different episode than the ones we usually do because we're not together in the same place. Where are you, Reza? And how are you?
I'm fine. Nobody needs to worry about me. As far as I know, I haven't got any coronavirus infection, but like everybody else, I'm lying low. That means I'm keeping quiet, out of sight, being discreet, down in Alicante.
In beautiful Alicante. And it's like the news when they go around the cities in Spain and around the world and say what's happening in different places. Reza, you're in Alicante. What's the situation there with coronavirus? Have you been outside?
Yes, I have. I imagine it's the same where you are. Are you in Valencia?
Yes, I'm in Valencia, in my flat, of course.
So as most people probably know by now, people are effectively quarantined. So you're only supposed to go out for certain reasons, valid reasons, and the streets are very empty. And I have seen police and civil guards, etc., stopping people, me included, asking what we're up to and making sure that we got a valid reason to be out. I've been to a supermarket, you had to wear a mask, the same in a pharmacy, and people keep the distance. So it seems safe enough. It's just a very strange atmosphere here. Would that be something similar for you?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, you're lucky because you've got Coco there and you can take the dog for a walk and get outside and have some exercise. But I mean, I really, it's very similar, but I don't mind being at home and being closed inside because I'm quite happy messing around and doing things on the computer. And I've got a long list of jobs that I've been saving to do when I get time. Well, now I've got time because there really isn't much to do. So I've been doing little jobs, organizing files, organizing things. So it really hasn't affected me that badly. But I know some people are having a really hard time because they can't go out unless they have a valid reason.
Yes, you're right about Coco, the dog. He's a great valid reason. He's really, really grown in popularity. Everybody wants to be with Coco.
Have you thought any more about my suggestion that we create a dog sharing app where we could share Coco with people in your area that want to go out for a walk?
Do you know, that's a good idea, but I have to tell you, people have got there before you. Such apps already exist. I haven't used them myself, but I do know there are dog walking apps in existence already.
How are you and the people around you, how are you feeling about the whole situation? Are you concerned? Are you worried? What's your general feeling about the whole thing?
I feel concerned, but not totally desperate or stressed out or anything like that. But yes, I'm concerned. Anybody could come down with a virus if you were lucky enough to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. I take that very seriously. But I'm positive that, you know, we're going to come through this. And we'll have learned a lot through the experience. It's a pity. Some people will get ill. Some people, very, very few people may even die. Very, very few. But, you know, that's sad. It's going to happen. But on the whole, I think we're going to come out the other side of this and we'll be wiser for it.
It was important for Reza and I to make this podcast and publish it this week because, as regular listeners know, we often record these podcasts weeks before we release them. And we wanted you to know that we're not oblivious to what's going on in the world, that we're currently in the similar situation as you are, and we're feeling the effects of the coronavirus also. In fact, you were affected by it because you were due to go to Belfast for the Fias holiday, and the plane that was going to take you there, didn't it turn around in the air?
It didn't turn around in the air. It was cancelled just before it took off, in my case. But there were planes that literally did turn around in the air. Mm-hmm. That did happen to some flights. But mine, I was on the way. It was due to fly in a few hours, and it was cancelled.
Right. And similar thing happened to me. I was at that conference in, I was in Orlando in Florida, and I had to come back on the 10th of March. And I was very lucky to get back. I needed to take three flights to get back to Spain. And all of those three flights were half empty. And I was very, very lucky to get back into Spain before the whole thing exploded and Spain was put on lockdown. If the country's on lockdown, that means that people are really restricted in their movements. They need a reason to go out and they're pretty much closed in their house. So I got back into Spain before the lockdown.
You were in America, yeah?
I was in America at that podcasting conference, yeah.
What's the latest situation there, do you know?
California, I think, is on lockdown or very, very close to lockdown. They've definitely cancelled social meetings and they've definitely restricted social gatherings. So they're becoming very, very strict. And I think that will gradually spread to other states. The problem is it's spring break in the US. And a lot of teenagers and younger people, they want to go out, they want to party, they want to get together and celebrate the spring break. They're not afraid of the virus. Well, of course, they're young, so they're probably not in huge danger. But the problem is if they catch it, they take it back to their family. They infect their grandparents and older people in their family, and that's not a good thing. So I don't know what's going to happen. Is there, I mean, let's not be too pessimistic. Are there any positive takeaways to this crisis? Any optimistic aspects to it?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. As I was saying earlier, I think we're all going to come out the other side of it wiser for the experience. I mean, just on a basic level, we're going to learn different survival skills, if you like, of how to survive in difficult situations. That's one thing, for starters.
Like how to find toilet paper in the wild.
Exactly, yeah. Maybe even how to fight for it.
Self-defense skills when you're fighting for hand sanitizer. As teachers, we are probably going to need to learn different skills because we'll be teaching online. Our academy, our school has told us that we need to give our lessons on the internet. So it's an opportunity for us to learn different skills, to learn more technology, to teach classes online. And maybe not for every profession, but certainly for many professions, working at home is going to open doors to learning different skills and different abilities.
I totally agree. It's a learning opportunity to learn more about your career, or even in a slightly more extreme way, even perhaps change careers. We're lucky there'll still be a job for us at the end of all this. But I'm sad to say there are people losing their jobs, particularly people in the hospitality industry, you know, restaurants, bars, hotels, that type of thing. And I guess some of them, sadly, very sadly, will have no choice but to perhaps look for a new job because of this. But rather than let that get to you, you know, it could be an opportunity to move on to something better.
Imagine that you always had a dream of doing a different profession or pivoting. The word to pivot, P-I-V-O-T, means to change direction in a different, go in a different direction, change your career or deviate or move a little from the way your career was going and head or go in a slightly different direction. So you could look at this positively and think, well, this is the time. I have no choice. I need to learn different skills and try something that I've maybe always wanted to try and go down a different path, go down a different road, and doors may open up for you. So it could be the best thing that's ever happened for some people.
Yeah, true. And moving to another area, apart from professional possibilities or opportunities or doors opening, on a social level, it gives people to do what we're doing, for example, to reach out online. Mm-hmm. Craig and I are recording this episode via Skype, so we're staying in touch online, and I'm sure lots of the listeners are using the opportunity to perhaps get in touch with family members or friends that maybe they haven't been in touch with for a while.
Yep, that's happened to me already, in fact. I've had messages from people who were concerned and worried about the situation in Spain with coronavirus, and they've contacted me and I've contacted other friends. And that's one good thing that's happened from the crisis of the virus, is that I'm back in touch with good friends and family members that live abroad.
And even closer to home, physically, we're probably spending more time with people who are close to us, because in Spain, we're effectively quarantined. We're obliged to stay indoors. If you've got brothers, sisters, parents that you live with, husbands, girlfriends, whatever, you're seeing more of them now, I guess, because you have to stay at home with them. So not only online, but actually physically in person, we're probably spending more time talking to people.
We hope that's a good thing for you, if you are spending more time with your family, your husband, your wife, your children. We hope that's a good thing. But if you're very busy and you don't get to spend much time with your kids, with your children, then this is a great time to hang out with them and to spend time with them. We hope that's a positive thing. Might not be for everyone.
Craig, of course, there is one more extremely important thing our listeners could do in this situation, isn't there?
They could study more English, couldn't they?
I mean,
isn't this a fantastic opportunity to go back to episode one of Aprender Inglés con Resi Craig and listen through all of the episodes, or go back and listen again if you've already heard them? You've got time now. You've got time to study. And one thing you could do, because you're maybe at home a lot and you're using the internet a lot, you could get in touch with the people who sponsor this podcast, our friends at iTalki. iTalki is a website that will help you get in touch and contact an online teacher. So instead of going to your academy, which maybe now you cannot do, you could connect using Skype or similar software and have a lesson in your home at a time and on a day that's convenient for you. And I would guess that the availability of teachers giving lessons at home on iTalki has really expanded. I would guess that you could find a teacher, a good teacher, any day, any time that you want to study, because many, many teachers, Reza and I included, are now teaching a lot more online. If you're interested in improving your English and taking advantage of your time at home, there's more information on our website. Go to inglespodcast.com/coronavirus COVID-19 special episode. In the show notes to that episode, you will see an iTalki link and an image. Click on that. If you sign up and pay using that link, iTalki will give you a $10 credit for your first lesson. So go and try it. I'm sure you'll find a teacher that's suitable for you. And Reza and I would like to thank iTalki very much for sponsoring this podcast.
So as you can see, there are many advantages to iTalki. And there's one that we never thought of mentioning till now. By using iTalki, you run no risk with your health. Something which can't be said for meeting a teacher in person these days.
That's true.
So with iTalki, there's absolutely no chance of getting coronavirus while using iTalki. Zero.
No coronavirus with iTalki. No computer viruses, because the platform is completely safe. And we both recommend you try it out and find a teacher on iTalki. Reza, why not look at some virus vocabulary? Because maybe you're listening to the news in English. It's a good time to look at different news outlets. Go to the BBC, go to CNN. I was listening on Al Jazeera the other day just to get a different viewpoint. They were speaking about different countries. On Al Jazeera, it was really strange. If you go to CNN, BBC, they focus on Europe and America and Australia. If you go to Al Jazeera, they give you news about other countries that are never mentioned. on other news channels. So it's a really good idea to practice your English on different news channels. What vocabulary would people expect to hear, Reza, when they tune in and listen to news channels in English?
Well, the first big word they're going to come across is epidemic or pandemic.
What's the difference?
Good question. At the start, they refer to coronavirus in China, where it began, as an epidemic. But now you tend to hear the word pandemic more. And that kind of sums up the difference. For me, as far as I understand it, a pandemic is really the same as an epidemic, but in various countries. Mm-hmm. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, more widespread and maybe even worldwide. So it's something that could affect any country, any place, anywhere in the world. So it's basically just wider and broader with further reach. And of course, with epidemics and pandemics and diseases and viruses that spread, the virus can infect you. You probably know that word, to infect. That's the verb. The noun is infection. So you get an infection, or you can pass on an infection to somebody else. To pass on, the phrasal verb, means to give to another person, to pass on the virus. The adjective is infectious, with a C and a T, infectious. So it's an infectious disease.
So COVID-19, isn't that the technical term for coronavirus?
Yes.
COVID-19 is most definitely an infectious disease. Or you might hear on some news channels, they might say contagious disease. It's the same. Contagious means that it can be passed on through contact, contagious. Infectious, contagious, or perhaps a bit more formal, you could use also the word transmissible. In other words, you can transmit the virus, you can pass it on. It's transmissible.
With a virus like a disease or a cold or the flu, you catch it. So use the verb to catch. You can catch a virus, catch the flu, or you can get it or come down with it. So that's a phrasal verb, to come down with, a three-word verb, to come down with the virus. You can come down with a cold, come down with a disease, and in this case, you can come down with the virus, which means you catch it or you've caught it.
And if you do come down with coronavirus, possibly one of the first symptoms that you will show will be a cough. That's C-O-U-G-H. But pronounced cough, a cough, or the verb to cough. So the same word is a noun or a verb. Of course, there are different types of coughs, and this has been pointed out with the coronavirus. They say that if you do have the virus, it will be a dry cough. It will be a dry cough, not a wet cough. Now, what's the difference between a dry cough and a wet cough? Well, a wet cough, it doesn't mean that there's like water flying all over the place, but yeah, hopefully.
Hopefully not.
I suppose it could, though, but it doesn't usually mean that. It just means that if you've got a wet cough, you will have mucus, plenty of mucus, you know, that runny liquid that you get often with colds or flus, and you'll feel it in your throat, comes down your nose and up your throat, and you'll feel it when you cough. But apparently that's not the case with this coronavirus. It's in fact a dry cough. And there are other types of cough. If your cough is dry, quite often we describe it as wheezing. How would you define that, Gregor? What would you give as an example as a wheezing cough?
It's almost like you're losing breath, like you don't have breath when you're breathing in. So it's and then you cough. So very shallow. Shallow is the opposite of deep. It's quite a shallow cough. Would you agree with that? And you're struggling to take air into your lungs.
That's it. For me, that's the key. Yeah. If somebody has a wheezing cough, just by listening to their cough, you know they're having breathing trouble.
And it's very common with smokers.
Yeah, exactly. So their lungs have been affected. They could even have a whooping cough.
Whooping?
In fact, Yeah, whooping.
Whooping.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Whoopi.
Whoopi Goldberg.
Nothing to. It's not Whoopi Goldberg, and it's nothing to celebrate. It's nothing to go whoopee about.
How do you spell it?
W H O O P I N G. A whooping cough. In fact, when I was a kid growing up, the whooping cough was like a pandemic at that time. It wasn't the coronavirus, but there was a pandemic which made babies, specifically babies, cough in a particular way, whooping. It was kind of as if they couldn't breathe. So kind of, you know, kind of going like, sorry for my horrible sounds, but that's what a whooping cough off. You kind of go,
Are you okay there in Alicante? You sound quite sick.
I'm putting that on. I'm imitating it. That's not for real, but it is a type of cough that some people have with certain conditions. I don't think it's the case with coronavirus. You might wheeze. You might have a wheezing cough, and you probably have a tickling cough as well. So to tickle is dar cosquillas. So a tickling cough is whenever you cough, you can feel kind of a funny sensation in your throat. It's like not painful, just kind of irritating. Like there's something there that won't quite go away. In fact, I think I'm about to do it. That was for real. That wasn't put on. I had a slight tickle there in my throat and I had to cough.
That's because we're speaking about coughing, so it's psychological. You want to cough.
Yeah.
And I don't think this is a symptom of coronavirus, but if you do this, that's a sneeze. And I know that the two main symptoms of the virus is a dry cough and a fever when you have a high temperature, a fever. But I don't think you sneeze a lot. Have you heard anything about sneezing?
No, as far as I know, it is not a symptom. It's not a symptom, yeah. But it's very confusing because people might sneeze who have the coronavirus, but it's not because of the coronavirus. They might have something else, or simply because at this time of year, you know, there are a lot of colds and flus and people do sneeze a lot. So yeah. You could have like an underlying, you know, already there, mm-hmm. an underlying condition like the cold, un resfriado, and get the coronavirus on top of that. So you might sneeze as well as, you know, have a dry cough, but they could be from two different conditions. This is causing a lot of trouble for health workers, apparently.
Exactly. And I actually am a high risk because I have a history of asthma and bronchitis. So because bronchitis is a respiratory disease, it affects my breathing. If I were to get the virus, it could be potentially very, very serious for me. That's because of the history I have of respiratory diseases.
Another useful word which alarms people when they hear it is the word outbreak.
Outbreak.
Outbreak, yeah. You hear about the latest outbreak. So an outbreak is where a significant number of cases have recently occurred or appeared. So obviously the initial outbreak, most people know, was in Wuhan in China. Mm-hmm. That's where the initial outbreak is. But obviously now there are outbreaks all over the place. So when you hear about their most recent outbreak, that means there's been a concentration of new cases in one particular area.
And what they're trying to do, I was reading today that it might take between 12 months and 18 months for them to develop a vaccine. Vaccine is vacuna in Spanish, and it's what will prevent the spread of the disease and the outbreaks in different places. So vaccine is the noun, and vaccination is when the vaccine is given to you. So people are vaccinated. They are given the vaccine.
By the way, as a trivial question, do you know where the word vaccine comes from?
It looks Latin, is it?
Yeah, it has a Latin connection, yeah. Has a Latin connection or a Spanish connection. But then again, Spanish has a big Latin connection, so that's no surprise. Think of the word vaca.
Ah, cow, because it's V-A-C-C-I-N-E. Is it connected to cows?
It is indeed. The first vaccination was discovered by fooling about with samples from cows.
Oh, really?
Yeah, something to do. Now, I'm not an expert in this. Obviously, we haven't got time to go into it. But cows played a role in the discovery of how vaccinations work. So they used the Latin word vacca, which happens to be the same as the Spanish, and came up with this word vaccine. So it all goes back to cows, actually.
I had no idea. Who would have thought? I had no idea cows had anything to do with it. We mentioned before that we are on lockdown here in Spain. So there's another word you may hear in the news, lockdown. Compound noun, lock, L-O-C-K, and down. So to be on lockdown means you're socially restricted. You're staying in your home unless you have a very important thing to do, like go and get food or go to the hospital, for example. Reza and I are both on lockdown, and that's why we're not in the same place today.
A word we've already used a couple of times so far is quarantine. That's Q-U-A-R-A-N-T-I-N-E. It sounds quite similar to the Spanish word. So to quarantine or a quarantine is a period when you're obliged to stay in a certain area and not leave it. In other words, it's very similar to the idea of isolation, but not exactly the same. Because quarantine is what we're all experiencing right now in Spain. We're obliged to stay at home, except for certain specific necessary activities for which we can go out. But apart from that, we've got to stay at home. That's quarantine. However, if you do get coronavirus and you need to go to hospital to be treated, they will maybe put you into isolation. That's slightly different. It's the same kind of idea, but it means that you will be put in a special place where nobody is allowed to come and see you except medical professionals, perhaps. They might put you in an isolation ward or an isolation unit.
And at the moment, you also hear in the news the expression self-isolation, which means you put yourself in a place and you isolate yourself. It's your decision and you control it. That's self-isolation.
Craig, with this self-imposed isolation, although, in fact, we have to by law in Spain, we've been told to stay indoors in quarantine, some people might be developing cabin fever. What's that?
Cabin fever. I think it's from the days when people in the winter were closed in a cabin, maybe a log cabin, a wooden cabin, all through the winter. So months and months and months and months without seeing anybody in the woods, in the forests, very far from civilization. And they almost went mad. They went crazy because we as humans, we need community, we need people, we need communication. And if you're isolated for a long time, that could lead to cabin fever. So that expression is used usually in a humorous way, although maybe that's going to change now, because depending on how long we're going to be isolated from communities, maybe we will start to get a little bit of cabin fever. Are you getting any cabin fever down there in Alicante?
So far, I'm okay. But then again, I've got Coco, so I've got my excuse to go out for a walk every once in a while.
Yeah, you're very lucky.
What about you?
No, as I said at the beginning of the podcast, I'm quite happy at the moment to be messing around with my things and playing around with the internet. For example, today I was looking at some software that will help transcribe the podcast episodes quicker because I'm starting to fall behind a little. We're about 5 or 6 episodes behind on Patreon. So I've been looking at different software and I like messing around by myself on the computer. I don't know if that will change in a couple of weeks, if I'll get some cabin fever. But at the moment, I'm actually quite happy.
And Craig, have you noticed any symptoms that might be associated with coronavirus?
Well, I have a list here. One symptom is a runny nose that people may experience. So if your nose is running, that doesn't mean it's not going like a fast walk, and you're it's not running fast anywhere. It just means that there's liquid or mucus coming out of your nose. So when there's liquid falling from your nose, when you have a cold or the flu, that's a runny nose. To get a runny nose, what other symptoms are there?
A sore throat is a typical symptom of coronavirus. That doesn't mean that everybody has these symptoms. These are just possible symptoms. So don't get paranoid, listeners, if you do have a runny nose or a sore throat. I had both symptoms a couple of days ago, by the way. I had a very runny nose and a sore throat, but I knew instantly what it was. It was hay fever, which I always get at this time of year. Hay fever is an allergy to pollen. So that gave me a runny nose and a sore throat. You know, just my throat was probably a little bit swollen because of the pollen going in there. It was sore. It was painful.
We mentioned before about the cough, C-O-U-G-H, cough, the dry cough, the wheezing cough. By the way, we should mention that we are not doctors. We've taken some advice from the internet and we've double checked it to make sure it's good advice, but we are not doctors. So if you are having any of these symptoms, please, please, please get in touch with a professional doctor. Go and see someone at your hospital or get some medical advice. Fever, we also mentioned before. And of course, difficulty breathing in some cases, especially if you have respiratory illnesses.
So Craig, what can people do to avoid getting these symptoms, to avoid getting the virus? In other words, how can you stay safe?
Well, you may have heard this on the news and in information broadcasts. It's really, really important to wash your hands often and well with soap and water. And they are recommending to do this for at least 20 seconds. So you could sing the happy birthday song twice. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday to Craig. Happy birthday to me. And then repeat it. I have a different song. I like to sing I'm H-A-P-P-Y. I'm H-A-P-P-Y. I know I am because I am. I'm H-A-P-P-Y. And then you repeat it. And that's more or less 20 seconds. And then you dry your hands.
I must admit, Craig, I think I speak for you. Correct me if I'm wrong. You've all your life been a lifelong obsessive hand washer like me.
Not all my life.
Ah, okay.
Not all my life. Only
all your adult life?
Only the last maybe, I don't know, 10 years, and I don't know when it started, but I do wash my hands quite regularly anyway, and I usually have a bottle of hand sanitizer with me when I go out. So I like to have just to keep my hands clean, right. Which is another thing they recommend. So get some hand sanitizer. If you can, make sure it has 60% alcohol, although it may not be easy to find these days. But make sure you either wash your hands regularly or use hand sanitizer regularly.
I must admit, even before the coronavirus scare, I was very, very conscientious about washing my hands, I must say. All my life, the first thing I've done, and I still do when I come in, is wash my hands. I've done that my entire life.
Do you know where that came? Does that come from your parents, perhaps? Your upbringing, your childhood?
I think so. Yeah, because very often I'd be outside playing football or mucking about, whatever. And the first thing my mum would always say, upstairs to the bathroom and wash your hands, young man. You're not having your dinner with those dirty hands. And I guess it's stuck. And so even if I'm not intending to eat or anything like that, when I come in, I always wash my hands. I've always done that my entire adult life and most of my childhood. I've washed my hands. So for me, it's absolutely second nature. It doesn't suppose any problem for me whatsoever. And I must admit, to see people come in off the streets and not do that would kind of bother me.
Yeah.
That they didn't do it. I just think, oh, I'm doing it. I think everybody should do it. I kind of feel it's their responsibility, especially with the coronavirus. Do you think I'm being a bit fussy?
No. It's absolutely, I agree 100%. And one thing that has always bothered me, even before the coronavirus explosion happened, was when you go to a public toilet, a bathroom, and you go to the toilet and you wash your hands, and then you have to touch the handle of the toilet to go out. And you know that many, many people have touched that handle and they haven't washed their hands. But you've just washed your hands. What do? Now, sometimes in some bathrooms, there's some paper near the handle. So I take off the paper and I open the toilet door with the paper and throw the paper away, because then I'm not touching the handle.
You're speaking my language, Craig. You're preaching to the converted. I'm exactly
preaching,
the same.
Preaching to the choir, they say. Preaching to the choir, yeah.
And in these days of coronavirus, listeners, you might want to copy us until it all, you know, calms down again at least.
In fact, I feel like I've been training for this all my life. Don't touch your eyes, your nose, or your mouth, especially if you haven't washed your hands. So with unwashed hands, if you've touched surfaces outside of your house that may be infected, don't touch your face, don't touch your eyes. This is one of the most common ways that the virus is caught and transmitted. So be very careful, very aware, very conscious of not touching your face with dirty hands.
And this sounds a bit hard, but if you think about it, it's common sense. Unfortunately, you just have to avoid close contact with people who are sick, and actually all people in general, especially in public places. The less contact you have with people, the better your chance of staying safe. Mm-hmm. It sounds a bit hard, but it's true, isn't it?
Yeah, we're going to have to do that, at least for the time being. And if you do get sick, make sure you stay home, except obviously if you need to get medical care. So if you do notice that you may have caught the virus, you suspect being infected, make sure you stay home and you don't contaminate and spread the virus outside. You're more likely to spread the disease if you go outside. And I saw a very good video from a doctor in the UK who said, don't think about how to prevent yourself getting the virus. Try to think of how you would not want to spread it to other people, because the philosophy is the same. Imagine you have it and don't spread it to other people. And if you think that way, first of all, it's more compassionate. And secondly, it's exactly the same protocol. You don't go outside, you wash your hands, you keep everything clean, and you're very aware of other people.
Another very basic hygiene tip is to use a tissue, pañuelo, a tissue, to cover your mouth when you cough or sneeze, and then throw the used tissues away as soon as you use them. Don't keep them, don't hang on to them. But if you don't have a tissue, they say you should cough or sneeze into your elbow. Yeah, into your elbow or your sleeve. So if you haven't got a tissue to cover your nose or mouth, at least you're covering it with your own elbow or sleeve, you know, so it's not just going out into the air. And they say that's better than your hands, because of course if you sneeze or cough into your hands, then with your hands you're very likely to touch something and you're spreading it. But we don't normally touch things, you know, with the inside of our elbow. So it's much better to sneeze in there if you haven't got a tissue.
When I was at this conference, instead of shaking hands, people were touching elbows when they meet you and say, oh, I'm Craig, I'm from Spain, I'm a podcaster. And say, yeah, I'm from San Francisco and I'm a podcaster. Oh, nice to meet you. And you extend your elbow and you touch elbows, and that was instead of shaking hands. So that's what people were doing at the conference.
Another thing you have to do, of course, is to clean and disinfect. In other words, get rid of any possible infections. Disinfect frequently any surfaces that you touch every day. So we're talking about tables, obviously, where you're going to eat, but other tables where you perhaps read or put a laptop or something. Door handles. The handle is the bit of the door you touch with your hands, obviously. Door handles, light switches, desks, computers, phones, keyboards, sinks that you fill up with water, pilas, toilets, and basically any work surfaces, anywhere where you work and anything that you touch. Have you heard, Craig, of the tips that authorities have been giving about how to keep your phone clean?
Yes, I have. Because there's some products out there that contain chemicals that could damage your phone, because your phone has a very thin film, F-I-L-M, a very thin layer, a kappa, of anti-grease or anti-reflection coating. And some products may remove this and damage your phone. So what they're suggesting, I think, is, tell me if I'm wrong, Reza, is you should dampen a cloth, just not make it wet, but just dampen a cloth, which means add a little bit of water so that there's a little bit of water in the cloth, maybe a little bit of soap from the like hand soap, and wipe your phone with that, and then dry it with a clean, dry cloth after. That's the best way to clean your phone.
That's right. That way you won't damage the screen or anything else. That's exactly what I've heard.
Definitely don't use the alcohol sanitizer on it. That's not a good idea.
Have you got any more tips, Craig?
Yeah, if you have a face mask...
You're lucky.
You're lucky.
If you have a face mask, you're a lucky person.
if you happen to know any doctors or dentists or nurses that can get you a face mask because they're not easy to find, make sure you wear it, especially if you're sick, of course. And also if you go outside and you're in the company of other people, it's a good idea to wear a face mask. Last week, I needed to go to the hospital with my brother-in-law for some treatment, and I had the face mask on all the time that I was in the hospital to protect me and to protect other people from possible contamination.
I actually do have a couple of face masks. I didn't need to buy any because I found in my cupboard some face masks, which I must have bought about 12 years ago.
What did you buy them for?
I bought them while workmen were repairing, were doing up my bathroom.
Oh, right. For the dust.
And there was quite a lot of dust in the house, because I have a bit of allergy to dust. So I bought these face masks to prevent me breathing in so much dust. But they're industrial face masks. They're not surgical face masks.
Right.
Surgical ones are the best. They're the ones that you really want. But good luck finding those. Very, very hard. So some people, me included, have been walking around with industrial masks. They're not as nice. It's not as easy to breathe with them. And they make you sweat a bit more. And actually, they let in more than a surgical mask. They're not as tight to your face. But they're better than nothing.
Although I did see on the news that in many, many places in Spain, people who have dressmaking shops that make alterations to clothes and also people who mend shoes, they're making face masks for free because their business has closed, obviously. So to make good use of their time, they're making extra face masks for the population, which is really nice. So if you are doing that, thank you very much for volunteering to do that.
I wonder what would happen with the coronavirus scare if a robber were to go into a bank now with a face mask on and say, you know, this is a stick-up. You know? Es un atraco. And they go, like, yeah, come on, you're only joking. Everybody's wearing a face mask. Go, no. It's really a stick-up. And nobody would take him seriously, perhaps.
It would be more effective if he went into the bank without a face mask and then everybody would dive down on the floor behind the counter.
Frightened of getting the virus from them, maybe, yeah?
Speaking of robberies and people going against the law, there have been some scams that we want to tell you about. A scam is where people try to take money from you or rob you, steal from you in a very deceiving, nasty, bad way. And two cases that have come to my attention, bogus healthcare inspectors. Bogus means false. So if somebody knocks on your door or rings your bell and says that they've come to disinfect your flat or your apartment or your house, or they've come to clean your house and they're from the health authorities, do not open the door. Do not let them in. That's a scam. And another one, priests, because churches have closed and people are not going to mass or to pray together in church. Some people are dressing up. To dress up means to put on the clothes of a priest and knocking on people's door and offering confession and offering to pray with the people inside. So again, be very, very careful at this time, because there are horrible people who are taking advantage of the situation. Reza, there has been studies made by John Hopkins, Department of Infectious Diseases. John Hopkins is a very, very famous and well-respected health center in America. And they've studied how long the coronavirus stays active on different surfaces. And maybe this will be useful. I found it interesting, but maybe it's useful information to pass on to people who are listening.
Yes, it depends on the surface. So not all surfaces are equally risky or safe. For example, Craig, plastic, very common surface in every household these days. How long do you think the virus, the coronavirus, can be active, can stay alive on a plastic surface?
Oh, maybe 2 days? I don't know.
It's actually a bit longer than that. According to the John Hopkins Department of Infectious Diseases, it's 5 days.
Wow.
Long time.
Yeah.
So say, for example, you or your hands were dirty, you'd been outside, you hadn't washed them, and you touched, a plastic tray in your house, there could be coronavirus there for up to 5 days.
Yeah.
That's a long time. It really just shows you just how many precautions you really have to take.
What about other surfaces? What other surfaces are there that they have different times then?
Yes, they've got aluminium. Would you say that's more or less than plastic?
I would say that's less time because it's not as absorbent. The surface is harder, if you know what I mean.
You're dead right, exactly. Only 2 to 8 hours.
Oh.
I say only, still quite a long time,
yeah.
But much less than 5 days for plastic. What about paper?
Longer than aluminium, I'd say.
Yeah, but 4 to 5 days. That doesn't surprise me, to be honest, because paper, you know, it's an organic thing, isn't it? It comes from trees, made from trees, you know, wood makes paper. I was surprised that plastic was 5 days, but I'm not surprised to hear paper is 4 to 5 days.
So I'm guessing that wooden furniture, tables, chairs, that would also be similar, like 4 days or something, right?
Exactly. What about glass?
Glass doesn't seem as absorbent as wood. So I'd say like aluminium.
Well, according to the John Hopkins Institute, it's also about 4 days for glass.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But your logic does apply to steel. That's acero. That's less time. That's 48 hours, 2 days.
So 48 hours and the virus dies, yeah?
Yeah. And then last but not least, surgical gloves. So a lot of us are wearing surgical gloves when we go to supermarkets, pharmacies, and even driving, you know, those thin, very thin gloves that surgeons use to avoid infection. But you can even be infected from those gloves if you're not careful. When you take them off, bear in mind that the virus could be on the outside, the exterior of the gloves. So you got to be careful what you do with them.
Yeah, because I've seen people in the supermarket cleaning their gloves with disinfectant.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I'm guessing, I mean, they're made of rubber, aren't they? So probably about the same as aluminium.
That's right. 8 hours.
Yeah.
About 8 hours. Quite a long time. So if you do use surgical gloves, don't just come home and leave them on the table or something like that. No, no, no. No, no, no. Throw them away or disinfect them.
Good advice. We hope that's been useful. But before we go, let's just speak for a couple of minutes about what this situation means going forward in the future for us as English teachers and also for you as students of English. I mean, we said before that for us, we're going to be moving to online teaching. So our school, the British Council, is effectively closed for face-to-face teaching. There are no exams because obviously exams bring people together, and oral exams, you have to be face-to-face with the oral examiner. So exams have stopped, classroom teaching stopped, and we're going online. Any other things that occur to you?
Yes, I'd be interested to hear from listeners, because our listeners are students, about the current situation for them.
Yeah.
So what options are students looking into? So we're teachers. We think about how we can help you, learners, from the teacher's point of view. But we'd be interested to know if any of you want to get in touch and tell me what you think are the best options open to you as students. How are you coping with the restrictions? If you regularly went to a class once or twice or maybe three or four times a week and now you can't, what are you doing? How are you continuing to learn your English?
You have been sending us voice messages, not specifically about the virus, but we have been receiving messages, emails from you, voice messages. So thank you very much for sending those to us. And we will be answering every single one of your messages and emails over the coming weeks. And we will be continuing with the podcast, won't we, Reza? We'll find some way to record an episode. We already have two or three recorded, so they will be released in the coming weeks. And we will keep giving you something to listen to and something to help your English every Sunday.
Yes, this is the first podcast that Craig and I have ever recorded when we weren't together physically. Although Craig has interviewed people for the podcast before online, haven't you?
Yeah, and I wanted to try this because one thing we've wanted to do for a long time is to bring other people, maybe teachers or people that can help you to improve your English, onto the podcast. And I've wondered technically how to do it with Reza and I recording locally and also connecting to Skype. Now I know it works. Now I know how to do it with the microphones here and in putting Skype into the recorder. So that's the tech side. The technical side seems to be okay. And we'll be able to do this in the future. So that's great.
Well, we hope this episode's been interesting for you. We hope many, many people of all around the world in all the Spanish-speaking countries, and not even necessarily Spanish-speaking countries, because we got our listeners in India and Russia and Finland as well. Hi to all of you. We hope as many people as possible listen to this. We might be able to say that we gone viral with this link.
Oh,
I couldn't resist it. I couldn't resist that awful joke. You all know, I guess, what to go viral means. As you know, whenever there's a clip, a video, or a link that lots and lots of people pass on to other people, we say it's gone viral. So who knows? This episode might go viral.
I think it's time to say goodbye. Thank you for listening. As always, please send us a voice message. We do think about you and we'd like to know how you're doing. We hope this podcast finds you well and happy, even though maybe you're feeling a little bit of cabin fever. We hope it's not too bad. You can reach us on SpeakPipe and send your voice messages there. That is at speakpipe.com. That's speakpipe.com/Inglés podcast. What about emails, Reza?
You could write to us. You could get Craig. He's craig@inglespodcast.com, or me, belfastreza@gmail.com.
And now that you're finding perhaps more time at home to study, you could visit our online store at store.mansioninglés.net. And there you will find some paid courses that will help you improve your English at home. Thank you to all of you who are supporting us on Patreon. You can see a list of all of our wonderful supporters over at patreon.com, patreon.com/Inglés podcast. And we'd like to say hello and welcome to our new supporters. Who are they, Reza? The ones who have joined us this month.
A big thanks to our most recent supporters. They are Jose Manuel, Santiago Casas Rey, Martorell, Ana Ruiz Cáceres, and BM. Is that the last one, Chris?
BM, who generously has donated $4 a month. So thank you very much for your generosity. We appreciate all of you. And I will be hard at work tomorrow transcribing episodes so that you can receive them through email through our Patreon program. If you would like to become a part of that program, go to patreon.com/Inglés podcast, and for only a minimum of $1 per month, you can get instant access to recent transcriptions. What's next week, Reza?
Next week's episode is all about Costa Rica.
So we did say that last week too, but because of this special episode, you'll be hearing it next week. Thank you so much for listening to us. We wish you well. Until next time, it's goodbye from me.
And goodbye from me.
The music in this podcast is by Pitts. The track is called See You Later. Music also by Stefan Kartenberg, Enibus Moon, and Dream On Me. Licensed under Creative Commons from ccmixter.org. Are you somewhere quiet?
Yeah, I'm somewhere quiet. Well, if Coco would go away, I'm somewhere quiet.